Hi friends, in this video we are going to learn about large exposure framework, which is a very important item of current affairs with regard to finance section of RBI and SEBI 2019 examinations. So friends, we are all aware that if the banks, they are in proper condition, they have proper financial strength, the entire economy is going to be working in a proper manner. Now if the banks, they are not in a proper condition, they have huge amount of NPAs or they have huge sorts of exposures which can be converted into NPAs, the entire economy or the entire nation's stability can be at stake. Now in this regard, RBI is particularly careful. RBI does not want that a particular bank should have exposure to any particular entity beyond a certain threshold. So if a bank has rupees 100 crores with itself, it should not be there that it should be lending 50 crores to a single entity or a single person. So if that person fails, the entire bank and ultimately the entire economy is going to be impacted. So friends, in this background, we are going to talk about the RBI's large exposures framework, which has been recently revamped by RBI with regard to the international scenario, particularly with regard to the Basel norms. And at the end of this video, we are also going to talk about some of the important MCQs which can be framed out of this particular topic. Now, before proceeding forward, let me quickly tell you about the excellent results that we have achieved over the past few years. Now, in 2017, in RBI Grade B, we had 27 final selections from our students, and in ABAD Grade A, we had 11 final selections from our students. And in 2018, we repeated the same success story, and in RBI Grade B, we had 70 plus final selections, and in NABARD Grade A, we had 26 final selections. Also, in 2018 SEBI Grade A examination, out of the total 84 selections, 41 of our students, they made it to the final list, and in the IBPS AFO examination, our students have got 100 plus interview calls. Now, if I talk about the different individual courses that we are providing, then they include RBI Grade B, SEBI Grade A, NABARD Grade A, RBI Assistant and IBPS AFO examinations. Now, apart from running the separate courses for all those individual examinations, we are also having some combo courses which you can avail. So, we have a combo for RBI Grade B, NABARD Grade A and SEBI Grade A. We are also having a combo for RBI Grade B, NABARD Grade A, SEBI Grade A, RBI Grade B and NABARD Grade A and SEBI Grade A. So we have all the requisite combos that you can choose from, and you can choose the appropriate course as per your requirements. Let me also tell you about our new course, which is very important for all the banking exams. This is the QRE course. QRE, that is Quantitative Aptitude, Reasoning Ability and English. So all these aspects which are very important for all the banking exams, they are going to be covered in this particular course. So guys, these were some of the headlines which were there in the news recently. Like the first one, complying with large exposure framework, banks disbursing loans at reckless speed may face teething problem. So RBI has come up with a new large exposure framework, and the banks which have been exposing themselves to big amount of loans, they are now going to be in trouble because now they cannot increase their exposure beyond a certain threshold to a particular entity or related entities. Further, RBI circular on guidelines on large exposure framework for banks. So this was another headline, and another one was RBI norms on bank exposure came into effect from Monday, which was 1st of April 2019. So these new large exposure framework circular of RBI has come into picture, and it has brought in some of the new norms which the banks would now have to comply with. So we are going to learn about all these norms, and also we are going to take a overall idea or broad picture of the related concepts and terms associated with it. Now, a bank's exposure to its counterparties. What are counterparties? To the persons or to the entities to whom banks has given their loans. So a bank's exposure to the counterparties may result in concentration of its assets to a single counterparty or a group of connected counterparties. So what a bank may do? a bank may grant most of its loans to a single party. Say it is giving all its loans to Reliance Industries Limited. And there may be another case in which the bank is giving all its loans to the entities which are connected with Reliance. It is not directly giving to RIL. It may be giving to Reliance Communication. It may be giving to any other Reliance company. So it is increasing its exposure to a set of entities. Now this can be a problematic situation, because if the bank is solely dependent on one entity, the failure in that particular entity may affect the entire operation of the bank. So you must have realized that there is a need that the exposure of a bank to a particular entity or to a particular group of entities must be curbed. Now, in order to address this concentration risk, RBI way back in March 1989 fixed limits on bank exposures to an individual business concern and to business concerns of a group. And since then, RBI's prudential exposure norms, they have evolved, and a bank's exposure to a single borrower and a borrower group is currently restricted to 15% and 40% of the capital funds respectively. So what does this mean? A bank cannot lend more than 15% of its total capital to a particular entity and 40% of its total capital to a particular borrower group. Now, if you talk about the RBI's new framework, then in 2016, RBI introduced this large borrower framework. And this framework aimed to reduce concentration of risk in banking industry, particularly which was laden with bad loans at that particular time. So RBI was concerned about tackling the issue of bad loans, and it did not want that a particular bank should be exposed to a particular entity more than a specified percentage. So in this regard, it came up with elaborate guidelines, but these guidelines, they were deferred. And now these new guidelines, they are going to come into force. Finally, they are going to be coming into force on 1st of April 2019. So the new guidelines on bank exposure to large borrowers, they are going to take into effect from 1st of April 2019, even though still there were efforts from Indian Banks Association to extend this particular deadline or to defer this particular deadline. But the RBI has finally made this new large exposure framework applicable on the banks. Now, in order to understand this particular framework, first and foremost, we must be aware about what are large exposures. Now, large exposures in common parlance, it means that a huge amount of money in the form of loans or other credit facilities has been granted by a bank to a particular entity or to a set of related entities. If we talk about in technical terms, then the RBI in the circular has defined the large exposure as the sum of all exposure values. So why this term all exposure values has been used? Why not directly loan has been mentioned? This is because the bank may have exposure in different terms. It may have granted it a letter of credit or any other facility. It may have given a bank guarantee. It may have granted it direct loans. It may have granted it overdraft. So there can be different sorts of exposures which the bank may have to an entity. So here it is mentioned, sum of all those exposure values of a bank to a counterparty, that is one entity, or a group of connected counterparties, that is set of related entities. If it is equal to or above 10% of the bank's eligible capital base, that is tier 1 capital. So if the total capital of the bank is, let's say, is 150 crore, out of which tier 1 capital or the eligible capital base is 100 crores, all those exposures which the bank will be having to an entity or a group of related entity, if it is more than 10% of 100 crore, that is 10 crore, it is going to be classified as large exposure. Now, some exposures, they have been granted exemption from this particular large exposure framework, that is, they are not going to be covered. What are they? Exposure to the government of India and the state governments which are eligible for 0% risk weight as per the Basel norms for computing capital adequacy ratio. Next is exposure to Reserve Bank of India or RBI. Next is exposure where the principal and interest are fully guaranteed by the Government of India. Next is exposure secured by the financial instruments issued by the Government of India. Intraday interbank exposures. Borrowers to whom limits are authorized by the Reserve Bank for food credit. Rural Infrastructure Development Fund deposits placed with NABARD. So for these particular exposures, there is going to be exemption from this particular framework. So these are very genuine exposures which should have been exempted, and that's why they have been exempted. Now, what are connected counterparties? So in common parlance, I've explained you that these are entities which are related to each other. But again, what kind of relationship are we talking about? Now, in technical parlance, we say two entities, they are connected, or two or more persons, they are connected, if the control criteria is satisfied. That is, one of the entity is directly or indirectly controlling the another entity. So for example, here you can see company X, it has say 75% shares in company B. So company X will naturally be controlling the company B, and automatically if the company X has say 60% shares in company C, it will also be controlling this particular entity. So in this particular case, this is going to be a case of connected counterparties. So there can be different cases, and I'm not going into detail of all those cases, and we even need not go into detail of all these cases for examination perspective. But then again, we must have a broad idea of what are connected counterparties. So banks must automatically consider that the control relationship criteria is satisfied if one entity owns more than 50% of the voting rights of other entity. So this has been specifically mentioned that if one entity is controlling more than 50% voting or more than 50% shares of other entity, it will be assumed that they are connected counterparties. Now, why there was a need of this new framework? On the first slide, where we started with this discussion, we learned that already there is a framework which is there in place, in which the limits also have been prescribed. Now, why there was a need to realign those limits? Now, the need was felt in order to align with the standards on supervisory framework for measuring and controlling large exposures which were issued by the Basel Committee on Banking Supervision. Now, initially, in January 1991, the Basel Committee issued the supervisory guidance on large exposure with regard to measuring and controlling these large credit exposures. And then again, in 2014, the earlier exposure guidelines, they were replaced with a new set of guidelines. And in this particular set of guidelines, the risk exposure or the large exposure was limited in relation to banks' tier 1 capital. So earlier, the exposure was to be limited or was to be restricted at a certain specified percentage of a bank's total capital funds. Now, the bank's total capital funds, they are going to comprise of tier 1 capital as well as tier 2 capital. But now, the Basel Committee, it shifted to curbing the exposure in relation to banks' tier 1 capital only. So RBI also felt the needs that it should restrict the exposure in relation to banks' tier 1 capital only, and hence these guidelines, they were issued in 2016, and finally they are coming into force from 1st of April 2019. Now let me also briefly tell you about the Basel Committee on Banking Supervision before proceeding forward. Now, this Basel Committee is basically the primary global standard setter with regard to prudential regulation for banks. It is basically providing a forum where the banks or the governors or the leaders of the banks, they can come along and coordinate on different supervisory and other banking related matters. It was formed way back in 1974, and its members, they generally comprise of central banks and bank supervisors. This committee has developed a series of highly influential policy recommendations which are referred to as Basel Accords or Basel Norms. So I believe you are already aware of the Basel Norms, Basel 1, Basel 2 and Basel 3. If you are not aware, you can just go into the Google and search these particular terms. You will get to know about them. I'm not going into detail about those Basel Norms as of now, because that will deviate us from our path. So let's come back to our topic. and discuss about what are the salient features of the new large exposure framework that has been made applicable by RBI. So this large exposure framework will change the current limit. Now, what is the current limit? Current limit is 15% with regard to single entity or single borrower and 40% for group borrower. And this percentage is computed with regard to total capital funds. We do not segregate between tier 1 capital and tier 2 capital. But now things are going to change. How things are going to change? Now, the new circular will change single borrower limit to 20%. So earlier it was 15% and now it is being changed to 20%. 20% of what? Tier 1 capital or eligible capital base, which is tier 1 capital here. At all times, with an exception of board approval to an additional 5%. So generally it is going to be 20% of tier 1 capital and it can be increased by 5% with the approval of board of directors. 2. Group borrower limit, it is narrowed to 25%. Now for group borrower limit, earlier the limit or the exposure was capped at 40% of the total capital funds and now it is being capped at 25% of the eligible capital base, that is tier 1 capital. So let's quickly revise that. For single borrower, the limit is going to be 20% of tier 1 capital, and for group borrower or related entities, the limit is going to be 25% of the tier 1 capital. Further, the new framework also requires a bank to report largest 20 borrowers, irrespective of the values of these exposures relative to the bank's eligible capital base. So in any case, largest 20 borrowers, they have to be reported by the bank to the RBI. Also, in a relief to banks, these norms, they are not applicable to banks advancing to governments or those carrying government guarantees. So this we have already learnt on the large exposure slide as well. So this is the most important slide of this particular discussion, and you must keep in mind the limits, the new limits which have been prescribed by RBI, and at the same time you must remember that these limits, they are now to be computed as a percentage of tier 1 capital. So what is eligible capital base? So eligible capital base, as I've already explained you, this is basically the amount of tier 1 capital. So when we talk about the capital of the bank, it is basically divided into two tiers, tier 1 and tier 2. Now tier 1 capital is the core capital. It's the pure capital, it's the core measure of a bank's financial strength because it comprises of common stock or equity shares and retained earnings of the bank or the retained profits which the banks have in their balance sheet. Now tier 2 capital is the impure capital. It comprises of impure profits or impure reserves like revaluation reserves, undisclosed reserves and hybrid instruments. So these are not equity shares, but these are hybrid instruments, like they can be convertible debentures which will be converted into equity shares at a future point of time. So tier 2 capital is basically a impure form of capital and tier 1 capital is the pure form of capital, and the exposures, they are to be calculated as a percentage of tier 1 capital under the new RBI large exposure framework. Now let's discuss some of the MCQs which can be framed out of this particular topic. So let's start with the first question. RBI defines large exposure as the sum of all exposure values of a bank to a counterparty or a group of connected counterparties if it is. Options are equal to or above 5% of the bank's total capital funds, equal to or above 5% of the bank's eligible capital base, equal to or above 10% of the bank's total capital funds, equal to or above 10% of the bank's eligible capital base. So we have covered this concept of large exposures, and in this regard we have seen that an exposure is going to be large if it is equal to or above 10% of the bank's eligible capital base, that is the tier 1 capital of the bank. So in this regard, answer is going to be option number 4. Next question. Which among the following exposures are excluded from RBI's large exposure framework? exposure to Reserve Bank of India, exposures where the principal and interest are fully guaranteed by the Government of India, Rural Infrastructure Development Fund deposits placed with NABARD, or all of the above. So friends, we have learnt about this RBI's large exposure framework, and in this regard we have seen that all of these, they are excluded from this framework. So our answer is going to be option number 4, that is all of the above. Next question, which of the following is incorrect about Basel Committee on Banking Supervision? Options are, it provides a forum for regular cooperation on banking supervisory matters. It was formed in 1988. Its 45 members comprise central banks and bank supervisors from 28 jurisdictions. None is incorrect. So friends, we have learned about the Basel Committee on Banking Supervision, and in this regard we have seen that it was formed way back in 1970s. So option number 2 is going to be the incorrect one here, and our answer for this particular question. Next question, RBI's new large exposure framework will change the current limit in respect of single borrowing limit of 15% of the capital fund to. Options are 10% of the bank's available eligible capital base, 20% of the bank's available eligible capital base, or 30% of the bank's available eligible capital base, or none of the above. So this we have learnt that as per the new large exposure framework, this limit has been increased from 15% of the capital fund to 10% of the bank's available eligible capital base. So earlier it was 15% of the capital fund, now it is going to be 10% of the available eligible capital base, that is tier 1 capital. Next question, which of the following is are correct? Tier 1 capital is the core measure of a bank's financial strength and consists mainly of common stock and disclosed reserves. Tier 2 capital is composed of revaluation reserves, undisclosed reserves, and hybrid instruments among others. Options are A and B, A only, B only, or none of the above. So we have learnt about the Tier 1 and Tier 2 capital, and in this regard both these statements they are correct. So our answer is going to be option number 1. So guys, these are going to be the answers to all the questions. So guys, this was all about our discussion. If you are having any query, you can mail us at hello@edutap.co.in, or you can reach us at 8146207241. You can call us or you can WhatsApp us. And I would also recommend that you visit our website www.edutap.co.in for regular updates and important content on the respective examinations. Thank you guys. I wish you happy learning and all the best from the entire team.